many of you like to praise? That was a quarter of the church. We don't need the quarter of the church to praise and worship. We need all of you to praise and worship. So how many of us like to praise and worship? That's a little bit better.
Hi, my name is Janaya, and today I will be doing opening prayer. Let's bow our heads for opening prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this Youth Day service. Please bless this service by being with us today. We ask also that we will continue to grow and become stronger as we look at your Son, Jesus, as our example. Bless the speaker as he shares your word to encourage us. May we always have a desire to share your love with others. Help us to be ready when Jesus comes again real soon. In his name we pray. Amen.
We are back, sharing crazy facts you might not know.
That is right. And today, Frankie, I have you covered with amazing facts about zebras that you might not know.
Starting out with our first fact, it is all about a family of zebras. Zebras are mammals, and their families are generally made up of a male, several females, and their young.
Zebras are considered endangered animals, and we have to help them stick around the planet. Like most people don't know, the average zebra lives about 25 years. And when looking at zebras and how much they weigh, that can be different depending on a zebra. Some zebras are around 400 pounds, and then there are others that can get up to over 900 pounds.
Wow, I did not know zebras were that large.
Up next, I want to talk about what zebras like to eat. Zebras are herbivores, so they like to eat grass. Also known as plain zebras, you can see thousands of zebras moving from region to region, grazing using their front teeth that are very sharp to bite the grass and their back teeth that aren't sharp to grind the grass for eating.
Okay, now when looking at zebras gathered together, they all pretty much look alike. Now, although many people know zebras by their stripes, every zebra is unique.
Where are you going with this one, bro?
Where I'm going is, just like humans have fingers and fingerprints, fingerprints can be used to identify a human. The same thing goes for zebra stripes. Although different zebras may look alike, every zebra has its own unique pattern of stripes.
That's pretty cool, bro. And with my next fact, it reminds me of me, you, and the crew when we hang out at school.
How are zebras like you, me, and the crew?
Well, zebras like to hang out together just like we do. It is common to see not just one zebra, but a group of zebras. Although we call ourselves a crew or a group at school, a group of zebras is actually called a herd or a zeal.
Yeah, I don't think our friends would like us saying we are a herd.
I think you're right. But continuing on with this next fact, if you see two zebras hanging out close to each other, you might think they're fighting or trying to eat each other.
What are you talking about, Lee?
Don't worry, Frankie. When zebras hang together, they also help to groom each other. When you see two zebras close together and it looks like they are biting at each other, they are not fighting or trying to eat each other, but helping to groom their fellow zebra by biting off extra hairs and helping each other look good.
So it's like going to Mr. Rosebud's shop to get a haircut.
Yeah, something like that, bro.
And there you have it, sharing a few amazing facts about zebras with you.
Happy Sabbath. The designated youth will now receive your gifts from the children's offering. He will come from the back to the front. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Creator of all good things and giver of every gift, Jesus, we thank you for the blessings you give us and ask you to help us to be good towards of those gifts. Allow our gifts to be a blessing to others. Amen.
Amen, church. It's grace that has brought us this far, and grace will carry us home. Time
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen again. Were it not for grace, you know, we serve a good God. And as I was preparing for this service, for this preached moment, how you doing, Jalen? Amen, amen. I've been calling him the drummer. So I wanted to make sure, you know, we start using his proper name. Thank you for that selection. Thank you for that selection. It was beautiful. Y'all gonna have to let me take my time this morning for a number of reasons. Number one, it's been a while since I've been up here. In fact, it has been almost a year to the day since I've been here, since I preached before. So I looked it up and it was August 13th. That I preach. So 1 year, but that's all right. That's all right, because if it wasn't for grace. So I was trying to figure out if I was going to share this with you. I've shared it with a couple of people recently, but back in April, but you've inspired me if it were not for grace. See, back in April of 22, I suffered what they call a transient ischemic attack. All right. Now, you medical professions might know that as a mini stroke. And if it wasn't for grace, I wouldn't be here. And if it wasn't for grace, you know, God, this is Lord, you just take us where you want us to go. It's an amazing thing to have God's favor. Huh? To have God's favor, because if it wasn't for grace, I wouldn't have been under the care of this naturalist, right? And I wouldn't have been monitoring all of my signs and doing all of this. So I truly believe that if it wasn't for that, when this happened, it wouldn't have been a mini stroke. It would have been a big stroke, and I wouldn't be standing here today if it wasn't for God's grace and his favor and his opportunity to give us one more chance. So I appreciate the opportunity. I value the opportunity. Thank you, Pastor. You know, some people will say, man, you looking good. I've been through a lot more than the way I look. If it wasn't for grace. The whole sermon may change up in here. If it wasn't for grace. But let's go ahead and get started. Our time is short. I do want to acknowledge a couple of folks. First of all, if my eyes didn't deceive me, I think Sister Mary and Sister Darlene came in here. Huh? If my eyes didn't deceive me. Hey. Who are them two in between y'all? Oh my goodness, y'all getting old, I'm not, amen. Y'all just have grown up, praise the Lord, it's so good to see you. It's so good to see you, it's so good to see you. Oh, we got a midshipman in the house too. Amen, amen, thank y'all for coming. Thank y'all for coming. We gonna get started. Wanna thank our online crew. Online is my good friend, Sharon Pringle. I have confidence that if it wasn't for her broken foot, she would be here. So keep her in your prayers. She's always faithful in supporting me in these preaching moments. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for allowing us to be here today. We thank you that as the enemy attacked, you didn't allow him to succeed. We thank you for your traveling mercies here to your house of praise, prayer, and worship. Lord, we repent of our sins. Forgive me for anything that I've done knowingly or unknowingly, because Lord, I want to serve you. I want to serve you right now in spirit and in truth. Lord, my ask this morning is that your Holy Spirit take this service over. Lord, we saw in Job how you were able to put a hedge of protection around him and his family. And I ask for that right now. I ask for that covering for me, for my house, but also for this church right now in this moment. Evict and expel anything that should not be here, anything that will hinder your people from hearing your word. Cover me. Use me. It's not about me, Lord, but you come forward and you come forth in a mighty way. Lord, I will be so bold as to say, make it so that it doesn't matter what I say. You use it and you translate it so that people hear what they need. We turn it all over to you right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the topic for this morning is, do the demons know your name? Do the demons know your name? And I'd like for you to read a most fascinating piece of scripture with me, taken from Acts chapter 19. So if you could turn to Acts chapter 19. And I'm going to ask you to stand as we read verses 11 through 20. I will be reading in your hearing Acts chapter 19 in your Bibles, on your cell phone, on your tablets. Sister Vastine, I see you out there online. Praise the Lord. I'm going to try to look at the chat for every now and then, because I know Sister Loretta's out. She's already been saying, amen, cover me. Thank you, Sister Loretta. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. So we are not just a church family here. We're a church family physically and virtually. Amen. 10 fascinating verses, packed verses, full of information and truth. The Bible says, now God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or aprons were brought from his body to the sick, and the diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out of them. And then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists took it upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, we exorcise you by the Jesus who Paul preaches. Also, there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, who did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? Then the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them, overpowered them, and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. This became known both to all Jews and Greeks dwelling in Ephesus, and fear fell on them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And many who believed came confessing and telling their deeds. Also, many of those who practiced magic brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. And they counted up the value of them, and it totaled 50,000 pieces of silver. So the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed. You may have a seat. Do the demons know your name? So I'm going to start this message off a little bit in an unusual fashion, because there was a story that was actually in our Sabbath school lesson for this quarter. So even though you may not have attended Sabbath school, you're going to get a little bit of it here. Amen? But this story was fascinating because it said that unusual events, is that all right? Yes. Okay, amen, amen. I want to make sure we're good. Unusual events began occurring at the home of 16-year-old Almira after she signed up for courses on the supernatural. The year was 1992. The Soviet Union had collapsed, and there was now interest in this once banned religion. Two Russians from Moscow showed up at Almira's school and offered these extracurricular courses on extrasensory perception. Elmira's parents forbade her from going to the courses, but the Russian teachers promised to reveal amazing secrets, including how to heal illness. Her mother had suffered from headaches, and for some time, Elmira wanted to help, so she secretly attended the courses. She was taught that she was surrounded by invisible good and evil forces, and if she mastered them, she could perform wonders. Alone at home, she attempted to put into practice what she was learning. She carried out a one-sided conversation with these unseen forces, saying that she wanted to control them. That night, when she turned off the light to go to bed, she sensed a presence in her room. After a while, the presence manifested itself during the day when she was home alone. She sometimes noticed a shadow running past a window. She was not afraid. She thought she was strong and she was controlling this invisible force. As time passed, she realized that the force was stronger than her. And she could not control it. Frightened, she stopped turning off the lights when she went to bed. She was afraid to go to sleep. And when she did finally go to sleep, she had terrifying nightmares. In desperation, Elmira asked her mother to sleep with her. But her mother refused after a few days of this, and she was still having the nightmares. After 6 months, her life was turned upside down. Her grades suffered, and she seemed to be in constant conflict with everybody, her teachers, her friends, her parents. All the while, she grew more terrified, and she didn't know where to turn. One afternoon, Elmira decided to take a nap after coming home from school. She was exhausted from all of those nights of her lack of sleep. She laid down on the couch, her face to the open door in the room. She was home alone. And suddenly she sensed a presence in the room. Looking toward the door, she saw the presence for the first time. It looked like a gray cloud completely obscuring the doorway. Elmira didn't know why, but she understood that something terrible would happen if she even blinked. She stared at the doorway for a while, which seemed like an eternity. Finally, she had to blink. And at that split second, the gray cloud darted to her, and she felt like she was entombed in a giant stone, helpless and unable to move. She struggled to breathe. She pleaded with the good forces to help, but there was no response. At that moment, she remembered a prayer that she had memorized. It was a non-Christian prayer associated with her ancestors' traditional religion, and she recited it. And for a moment, she was free and could breathe, but the presence then recaptured her. She repeated the prayer again and again and again. She was released, recaptured, released, recaptured, released, recaptured. Growing weary of the struggle, she frantically wondered what she could do to save herself. Abruptly, she remembered that one of the Russian teachers at the supernatural course had mentioned Jesus Christ was more powerful than all good and evil forces. The thought flashed into her mind to call on Jesus. She opened her mouth to speak. She only managed to utter the first syllable of Jesus' name, and the gray cloud fled. Amen. I got happy at that point. She felt like Jesus had entered the room and thrown the evil captor off. But what does she do now? She went to her family's church for a couple of months. She slept a little better, but decided that Jesus was her only way out. What should she do? And look at God. Just so happened, her sister, Phaniah, comes home with two friends that Elmira didn't know and found out that they were two members of the local Seventh-day Adventist church which happened to be right down the street from her apartment. So she started to relate the story, and then one girl says, "That is Satan." And the other girl said, "Elmira, you entered into Satan's territory by taking those supernatural courses. But Jesus is on your side. Only he can free you from Satan's power." So she started going to the church. And after several weeks, her parents found out. They weren't real happy. Her neighbors saw her walking, so they were trying to block her. But she was determined to keep going to church. But the evil presence persisted. The spirit kept coming at night, and Elmira began to pray out loud, in the name of the blood of Jesus Christ, protect me from Satan so I could sleep. She prayed this prayer every night, and the prayers dispelled her spirit, but she became scared. She told the pastor, and the pastor suggested that she start to read the Bible out loud. And you know what happened when she started reading the Bible out loud. Finally, all this foolishness stopped. So one night, she confessed all her sins out loud to Jesus. And the story says, after that, she slept better than she had in a long time. She finally stopped being afraid. And when she read the Bible and prayed, the spirit left. She realized that even though the spirit was strong, Jesus was stronger. Now, let me bring it close to home. I had a friend who told me about this young lady he was dating. And this young lady confessed to him that she practiced witchcraft. And she started telling him the stories about how she would practice witchcraft and she would conjure up things and money and relationships, anything she wanted in that evil spirit, jewelry, whatever. But like Elmira, also came the nightmares and fears. See, there's a terrible cost that you have to pay when you start playing with that stuff. You can't make it to heaven. The Bible is clear in Revelation. You can't make it to heaven if you are playing in the devil's toy box. And then she said that then she stopped. And when she stopped, she lost everything that she had gained from what she had done. I'm not really sure if she gave up that stuff. And I guess I should have asked her more questions about whether she was out, really out. That's right. I was the boyfriend. So, yeah, eventually we did break up, and eventually she did become a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But I still can't tell you now if she still wasn't practicing witchcraft. So what are those two stories trying to say? Satan is real. I don't care what society is trying to tell you. Satan is real. People following Satan and practicing Satan is just as real as you and I sitting in this church. On Wednesday night, Brother Keith said, they talk about this thing more in the islands than they do here. I don't know why we don't talk about this stuff, because it is real. The demon possession is real. The Bible is clear about that. You remember the scripture? Where Jesus ran into this brother who the chains couldn't hold. And he asked him his name and he said, "My name is Legion." Huh? "We are men. And send us in the pigs." Y'all remember that? He was possessed. There was in Matthew, there was a gentleman who was possessed by a demon and couldn't talk. He was mute. Y'all remember that one? What about the father who brings his son to the disciples who has a demonic spirit asking for help, and the disciples can't help them until Jesus comes? And then Jesus said, "This kind can only be defeated with prayer, fasting and prayer." All right, so
This is all just setting up because we're about to dive deep into that scripture. There are a couple of scriptures I want you to keep in the back of your head. One, Ecclesiastes says there's nothing new under the sun. So what we're reading about here is also present in our time. Amen? In Ephesians, the Bible said we wrestle not with flesh and blood, right? Sometimes we get caught up struggling, but we forget this. We don't understand the things that we are wrestling with are not flesh and blood. They are spirits, and spirits can only be dealt with spiritually, right? Right? And lastly, this is one the Lord's been working with me. He dropped this in my spirit a while ago. A lot of times, see, these people do this to get things, to get power, to get what they want. But the Bible has already told us, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. All right, we got that foundation? All right, now buckle up, because this scripture has messed me up. Can I take my time? All right. Praise the Lord. So Paul was in Ephesus, and here's the context for this message. So follow along. Acts chapter 19, verse 11. The Bible says, now God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or apron were brought from his body to the sick, and the diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Was it Paul? Yes, but it was God working through Paul. And because of that relationship that Paul had with God, with Jesus, he was able to walk in authority so that his residual presence still had power and authority. Now yeah, I don't think y'all got that. I'm here in the room. I'm speaking, but there was so much power when you leave the room, there's still power and authority. I don't know. That was good to me. That was good. Woo. All right. So that was the context. So the story goes that there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest. That's 14. We're going to go back to 13. They were itinerant Jewish exorcists. Itinerant Jewish exorcists that took it upon themselves. That's where they got into trouble. See, whenever we start following the God of me, myself, and I, whenever we decide that I'm going to follow my own opinion, that's when we get into trouble. See, Proverbs says there is a way that seemeth right to a man. But the end of that way is death. So that's where they started messing up. These itinerant Jewish exorcists took upon themselves. They thought this was a good idea to call the name of the Lord Jesus over the evil spirits. We exorcise you. Now, we exorcise you by the Jesus whom Paul preaches. Now, this is the interactive part of the message. I know we don't do this often, but what was the problem there? What was wrong with this? What was wrong with this? They didn't know Jesus. They didn't know Jesus for themselves. They had a second cousin, once removed, twice removed kind of relationship. They didn't know him for themselves. These itinerant, now that's important. That meant they went from town to town, place to place. This was their job. Their job was exorcism. Now, I have to believe that they were successful in that job, or they wouldn't have been itinerant. They would have been one time out and I'm done. So they were itinerant Jewish exorcists. These were church folk. These were church folks traveling from place to place, expelling spirits from a person or persons or a place. But then they saw the power and authority that Paul had and decided we need to get in on this for ourselves. Huh? This is looking good. Maybe we can use this. Now we got to be careful when we try to copy someone else's success or someone else's gifts. God made each of us unique. He made each of us, he gave each of us gifts and a purpose. See, I would love to have this brother's gift of singing, huh? But if I got up here and I tried to sing, that's not my gift. A whole nother message is going to come out this morning. Amen? So this morning, we have to remember, relationship, stay in your gift, but we shouldn't be too hard on these brothers. At least they were out there doing the work. Because sometimes we can sit up on our high horse and say, look what they did. They were out there doing the work. Yes, they made some bad decisions, but at least they were out there. 15, and the evil spirit answered. What you mean the evil spirit answered? This is the evidence of demon possession. And you have to be careful and you have to be prayed up because you don't know when you're talking to a demon. You don't, because clearly it says that the evil spirit answered. So this is evidence of the demon controlling the host, the demon using this man, talking through him. But it's also evident that the demon clearly knew who Jesus was. Huh? Because he says, Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. But who are you? Huh? Who are you? So it's logical to think and understand that if the demons don't know them, they don't know Jesus. Is that a logical assumption? Yes. It's also logical to then say, if you don't know Jesus, you have no power and authority. You have no power and authority. Therefore, you are vulnerable to those demons. Am I making sense this morning? Am I making sense this morning? Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. But I don't know you clowns. And proceeded to beat them like they stole something. The Bible says then, you start to visualize this and my mind keeps going. It says, and then the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them, overpowered them, and prevailed against them. Now, how many of them was it? What did the Bible say? How many sons?
Seven.
One man leaped on seven, overpowered seven, and prevailed against seven. So much so, the seven ran out of the house naked and wounded. That demon beat them like them folks got beat down in Montgomery, Alabama. You knew I had to say something about that. That demon beat them out their Crocs. And if I were to have a modern version of the Bible, I think that demon had a chair. Now, don't hate, because I'm still struggling with that whole thing. As a Christian, I don't condone violence. As a Christian, I don't want to see anyone hurt. But I still enjoy that thing. Y'all need to pray for me. Y'all need to pray for me. But see, I kind of fix it up for myself. Don't y'all do this, right? Don't y'all try to fix up wrong, because you can't fix up wrong. But the way I fixed up wrong is, it was just like David and Goliath, right? right versus wrong, huh? The giant versus the little kid, and the little kid prevailed. That's how I fix it up in my head, but we have to have love for everybody. So I'm still struggling with that, so y'all pray for me this week, okay? Because if I get one more video or meme, y'all pray for me. But okay, violence, we know violence is not the answer, but it did feel good to see them folk come together in defense of that employee. It did seem good. But this demon beat them so badly, they ran out of the house naked and wounded and bleeding. I can't see no regular man beating up seven people like that. Stripped them of their clothes. So I can only believe, the only assumption I can have then is when someone is demon possessed, they can do things that normal people can't do. Is that right? But I'm also understanding that I am no match for the devil without Jesus. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, so that was the story. Here was the reaction. Just like in Montgomery, that thing went viral. That thing went viral. It said it became known to all the Jews and Greeks dwelling in Ephesus, and fear fell on them, and the name of the Lord was magnified. Everybody found out. Everybody knew what happened. And I'm so fascinated by this because if you think about it, this was the devil triumphant over these men, but the Lord's name was magnified. Bible says that the rocks will cry out. God can use any situation. It's proof that he can use any situation to magnify his name. But then something interesting happened. And many who believed came confessing and telling their deeds. They heard about it, they saw it, and they understood the power of Jesus. And they said, I need to get my life together. But here's where it also gets interesting. Many of those had practiced magic. Well, hold on, let me do this. At the end of that scripture, it has something very interesting. And they counted up the value of the books they brought, and it totaled 50,000 pieces of silver. I need to paint the picture, and I need to put that in context so you understand really what's going on. Many scholars believe that one silver coin was 1 week's salary. So this was 50,000 times 1 week's salary. If I put that into today's society, the Bureau of Labor Statistics says the median salary for 1 week is $1,085. If you multiply that by 50, that's $54 million of books that they brought out of their house to be burned. Just think about that. Think about how much evil, how many worshipers of Satan there were. And remember I told you there's nothing new under the sun? That's right. We are at war with an enemy who has become bolder. And it said, and the word of God grew mightily and prevailed. Now, I'm about to come down your street now. About to come down your street. Young folks, can I talk to the older folks just for a second? Is that all right? All right. Thank you, London. We appreciate that. Yeah. See, because you know when I say that, I'm about to meddle. You know that, right? So I'm wondering how many of us older people are looking at this story and saying, yeah, I know in Revelation it says that if I'm into witchcraft, I'm not getting into heaven. Yeah, but I'm not into witchcraft. So I don't have nothing to worry about. Some of y'all might think like that. There was this Baptist preacher called Derek Prince, and he put it this way. Now, he specialized in deliverance ministry. And he said that witchcraft is using any power, not the Holy Spirit, to get something or someone to do what you want them to do. Witchcraft is using any power that's not the Holy Spirit to get someone to do something that you want them to do. Tools like manipulation, intimidation, domination, church politics. Any power that's not the Holy Spirit that you use to get what you want is witchcraft. And if you practice witchcraft, the Bible says there is no place for you in heaven. Oh, shucks. Okay, now some people like, I don't know who Derek Prince is, but I don't like him. But I'm not listening to Derek Prince. The Bible says in 1 Samuel 15:23, Samuel's talking to Saul, and he says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. So this messed my mind up until I understood that using forces or tools that's not the Holy Spirit to get our own way, it's the same thing these witches and warlocks are trying to do. They are operating outside of God's way to get their own way. So how can God trust us when we get to heaven if we haven't submitted to his way? It's not, okay, y'all need to repeat this after me. It's not my way. It's God's way. We cannot operate outside of God's way, because if we do, in my study, we are practicing witchcraft and we will have no home in the kingdom. All right, young folk, can I come down your street now? Now, Pastor, this is probably a Sabbath afternoon program, but I have to be a little bit clear here. Because Satan is operating in plain sight, going after our young people. And unfortunately, we aren't educated enough to that we don't even understand and see Satan's signs and movement and can't identify his people. So yesterday we were in Walmart. And I love God because he gives you these nuggets, because I'm like, Lord, is this what you want me to preach? And he'll just drop like, yep, see? So there was a young man in there with a hat, and that hat had a 5-pointed upside down star in a circle. Now, if you don't know, that is the symbol of the devil and someone who is following the devil. But it's not just a 5-pointed upside down star. It's a black and white checkerboard. Have you seen these floors with the black and white checkerboard? Yeah. Do you know what see, we need to have an AY program on all this. We know what the 666 symbol is, right? Yeah. Do we know what the owl symbol is? Owl. O-W-L. Owl symbol. The pyramid, the all-seeing eye. So do you think when these artists and entertainers go up in these awards shows and they thank God for what they have just accomplished, do you think they're thanking the same God? All right. Amen. Good. Now, when you see these artists wearing these big crosses, do you think they are following the Jesus that you're following? No. Many of them wear the cross celebrating Jesus' death, or they'll have them upside down. You know, Satan is all over. There's an artist. I hate to mention his name, but I am. This artist called Lil Nas X. Came out real kind of nice. He had that song, Old Town Road. Right, with the little horse, and you know, everybody singing it. And then he turned in one of his last videos, he's sliding into hell having sex with the devil. And then came out with these Satan shoes. Satan's shoes with the upside down star and reportedly had a drop of human blood in it. But our young people are following them. On the last Grammy, Sam Smith did a whole satanic service at the Grammys. Lady Gaga has been clear about the pain that she suffers from her demon possession. Katy Perry, who grew up as a child of traveling ministers, talks about how she sold her soul to the devil. Jay-Z and Eminem, they will talk about how they don't write their songs. They go into what they call Rain Man. And the songs come to them and through them. Who do you think are giving them these songs? We talked about the owl. Now, this is a question for the young people. What artist has an owl as their symbol, has an owl on their plane? Y'all don't know. Good. Praise the Lord. Amen. Drake. I'm just throwing a bunch of stuff out here because I want you to understand the battle that we are in and be aware and understand that. So Beyonce was just here. Amen. Queen Bee. The leader of a beehive, of the beehive, right? Do you know what they call a coven of witches? A hive. A hive. That's what they call it. Now, she talks openly. See, you have to understand what's going on around you. She talks openly. She has a video out there where she says, the people want to see Sasha Fierce, my alter ego. I can go into rehearsals and I can sing and I can do things, but I can't do what she does. Her drummer has sued Beyonce. You want to know what she sued her for? Extreme witchcraft. So this is public record. She has a lawsuit for harassment and a restraining order for extreme witchcraft. We have to be careful what we watch, how we spend our time, what we put up as our God. Because what D.K. Beale says it like this, what people revere, they resemble. What people revere, they resemble either for their ruin or their restoration. You know, it's always, now I'm going to hurt some folks' feelings right now, but it's always been interesting to me that the television is always in the center of the room. With the chairs all around it, like it's an idol that we're waiting and watching. It always bothered me the name of television. Now, some of y'all gonna say I'm crazy. Now, tell the vision. All right, y'all ain't messing with me right now, but that's all right. Whatever we worship, it recreates us in its image. That's why the commandment, have no other gods before me. 2 Kings 17:15 puts it like this, and they followed vanity and became vain. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. What we watch, what we worship, we become. Now, let me close this. I'm like, Lord, how do I land this plane? How do I land this plane? So first, for the youth, the first thing I need to say, the first thing Lord wanted me to say is, don't be afraid. Amen. Don't be afraid. I know some of this stuff sounds scary. But the Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. Now, see, and this thing is important. It's a spirit of fear. Because my mama had a spirit of fear. My mama worried about everything every minute. And that thing came down to me, and I was a worrier too. Until I said, Lord, you got to release me from this spirit. Generational spirits. So we as adults, we have to recognize the generational aspects of this, of what we're doing. So anyway, so don't be afraid. Let me share this one thing with you, and then we'll move on. So I talked about that episode where Jesus ran into the demoniac who was named Legion. But if you read that scripture closely, Mark chapter 5, verse 6, it says, when he saw Jesus, when the demon saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshiped him. The demon ran and worshiped Jesus. The demon has no power of you with you if you have that relationship with Jesus. And then he said, and he cried out with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? This is demon speaking. I implore you by God that you do not torment me. Young people, don't be afraid of the demons, because the demons are afraid of Jesus. Number two. We studied this scripture, Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 20. When you get home, read it. We saw what happens when you have a second cousin twice removed relationship with Jesus. Your relationship with Jesus can't be my mama's relationship, my grandfather, grandmother's relationship, the pastor's relationship. The relationship has to be one-on-one, you and Jesus. They knew the demons didn't know the name because they didn't have any experience with the name. See, these itinerant Jewish exorcists saw the success, but they didn't understand what made it work. We don't want a superficial secondhand relationship. We need to have a relationship with Jesus so that the demons know your name because you know Jesus. Lastly, young people, we need to pray. Now, I'm going to share something with you just real quick. I know the time is late. I apologize. Hopefully, so I'm still all right. Well, I guess I took up the time, so I'm all right. Okay. Someone shared this with me a little while ago, and it's really helped me, because they said prayer is an acronym. So young people, I want you to pray, and I want you to use the acronym of pray, of prayer. So when you start your prayer, start with P. P is praise. Praise the Lord for what he's done. Praise him. Praise him. You can go ahead and start playing something. We landed now. What's the next letter?
R.
Repent. 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 P is what?
Praise.
R is? Okay. Third, A. Ask. Ask. Now, the most powerful ask of God is to ask in his own voice. So ask in the scripture. Father, you said no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And then why is yield? I turn it all over to you, God. That makes sense? What's the P?
Praise.
What's the R? What's the A? And what's the why?
Yield.
Yield. So pray and read the word. If you find yourself in a terrifying situation like Elmira did, I want you to, just an easy one to remember. What happens if you have an emergency? What do you dial on your telephone? 911. So I want you to turn into Psalms and start with the 91st chapter and the first verse. They that dwell in the secret place of the Most High. So now let me do the appeal. Oh, shucks now. Yes, yes, yes. Lord have mercy. This was good to me. This was good to me. But now we need to ask for something. We need to ask for something. We need to have an appeal. So I'm going to ask, and this is more for the older folks. I'm going to ask that after this message, if you would do one thing for me and one thing for Jesus, and that is to intercede for our children. If you would provide a prayer covering for our children. If you would stand in the gap for our children, I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm going to ask you to stand. So that's the first thing. The second thing is if you are will go home and do what the folks in Ephesus did, they got that mess out of their house. If you are willing to do that, those things that Satan has allowed to creep into your homes, I'd like for you to raise your hand. All right. Now, some of y'all say, I ain't got none of them books, but I bet you got some Beyonce or Jay-Z or Drake in your playlist. I bet you have some video games. Satan uses everything. Get that stuff out of your house. If you don't know what to look for, ask God. Ask God. And then lastly, if your desire is that your relationship with Christ is so tight that the demons know your name, I'm going to ask you to raise the other hand. Father, your word is so good. Lord, let us leave here not afraid, but empowered because of your son's might. All we have to do is ask. The Bible says that he's standing at the door asking to come in. And all we have to do is to open the door. And because we let him in and we allow that relationship to grow, the demons will know our name. So let us leave here not afraid, but walking in the power and authority of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for this time. We thank you for what you've done. And until we meet again, Lord, be with us, cover us, protect us, grow our relationship with you. And help us to be saved when your son soon comes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. What do you say to that message? What do you say to that message? Realizing how realistic Satan is important. Because it's very easy to fall into the traps of Satan when you don't know it's a trap. And so Elder Willie spoke of a psalm that sits very heavy in my heart. Growing up, my mother would always just rattle this particular psalm off. As I grew older, I started to realize why she did that. There are certain psalms that are assigned to certain things. When there are certain difficulties going on, certain psalms belong to that. when there's certain celebrations going on, certain songs belong to that. And so our children, I just want to put an assignment on you, our young people. I know most of them are in the back. They went for a little break and a snack. But if you can hear me, Sister Frances, if you can convey this to them, I want our young people, those in the sanctuary as well, to learn Psalm 911. To learn Psalm 91, verse 1. Now, if I don't know the whole psalm by memory, I know Psalm 91 by 1 by memory. We grew up hearing it. They that dwell in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You see, that is the psalm that's going to cover you. When people are lying straight to your face and they think you don't know, you know, because you are dwelling in the secret place of the Most High. Oh, in the moment where you are concerned about lies, or you're concerned about cheating behaviors, or you're concerned about people doing wickedness towards you. If you have dwelt with the Lord, and as Pastor Anastasia says, you just ain't visit, but you have dwelt with the Lord, you will have wisdom that you didn't even know to ask for. Your eyes will be open in a way that even surprise you. God will be covering you in a way that you didn't know to ask. Elder Willie could have been sick right now. He could have been in a wheelchair. But glory to God. Glory to God. He testified some months ago about his A1C, is it? And the reversal and all that stuff. Listen, it could have been Elder Willie's last, but they that dwell in the secret place of the Most High. So young people, I'm going to ask you, learn the 911 Psalm. You're going to learn Psalm 91, verse 1. I'm going to give you between now and the next youth day. You should be able to learn it this week, but between now and the next youth day, Psalm 91, verse 1. And you come and you let me know that you know it. And we'll go from there. You know, I'm good on my word, so we'll go from there. Now, I sat and I fumbled around all service because I was so desperately trying to get all my thoughts together. You see, when the Spirit of the Lord is hovering, sometimes it's hard just to settle down because so many exciting things are being said. I don't want to miss it. And so the Spirit of the Lord has been hovering all week long. We funeralized Sister Diggs. And if you attended the funeral for Sister Diggs, you realize that you really attended an evangelistic meeting. What do you say? Come on now. Where afterwards, the grandsons came to me and said, Pastor, we will be volunteering on Sunday at the block party. Now, let me explain to you why that's so deep. You see, Sister Diggs, her life surrounded the children growing up in the Lord. It surrounded community service. And so the Lord had us preach towards that. And the young men, they just kept looking all service long. And it was when we got to the cemetery, they just pulled me to the side like we knew each other from somewhere. I said, Pastor, we need our outreach shirts. We will be coming. And all week long, it sat with me that God put it all together so that he could reach his sons at this time. I couldn't sleep one of the nights this week. I kept tossing and turning. Because this is not just block party where we eat Kona ice and we have food and we go in the bounce house. No. Everything that the church does is to possess the gates of the enemy. Every single thing. And so when we go out tomorrow, if you're staying in, you are praying between 1 and 4. Because as Beacon Light and our friends step into Robinwood, the Spirit of God has already been hovering, has already been preparing the way for us to deposit more Jesus into their lives. I guarantee you, it is not of our works. It is of the works of God. But when the people of God are obedient, oh my goodness, the stories that will come. So tomorrow, meet us here at the church at 11 a.m., please. Help pack up. It's not a lot of stuff to pack at all, trust me. This year, we have a lot of more partnerships, and we're not packing a lot of stuff, just a few items. And then we head down to Robinwood. We set up, and we begin to pray. And then between 1 and 4, it's action time. It's action time. I hope I sleep tonight. I'm so excited. I'm like a child the night before school. When you can't sleep, that's me. My truck has been packed since Wednesday. You hear what I'm saying? All of my items for the block party have been in my truck since Wednesday. I'm ready to see God do his thing. I have an expectation of our Lord because he has said something to me, and I'm happy to hold him to it. And so the demons that Elder Willie has spoken about, they are very true. Satan would like for us to kind of back away and be nervous. Nervous of what? If you are dwelling in the secret place of the Most High, what are you afraid of? Fear thou not, just stick with God. My friends, as we prepare to move on along with the service, offering and other things, I would just like to pause right quick and to celebrate and thank the Harris family. You see the Harris family, you can give them a round of applause, please. Thank you so much. I would just like to acknowledge them specifically, not just for coming and lifting our souls in song, not just that, but you see, they are in a process of grieving right now as their mom has recently passed away. As you know, we've been praying about that, and they came here to worship, but also came to give us, help us worship by providing us with music. And so it's important to me that we give them a round of applause and that we acknowledge them in this moment for doing what they really didn't have to do. Anita's family came all the way from Trinidad. That's not next door. That's not next door. And so I really wanted to make sure that we acknowledge that. Sister Simmons, if you don't mind these flowers, or Elder Willie, thank you. If you could just please give that to Neetha. Neetha, on behalf of our church, you have sacrificed many, many times. You have come here to sing. You have sung here for various programs. And it means the world to me that you all sacrificed and did this when you didn't have to. So thank you so much for y'all's sacrifice today and at other times. Know that our prayers are with you. Our love is with you. And most of all, like your mama would say, when the Lord comes, we'll see. God bless you. I'm sorry, I told you, I'm so excited, I forgot. Listen, I haven't even talked to the board about this, but I'm gonna go ahead and say this. You know, God is so good that God will provide for us everything we need. Remember when I first got here, I told you we don't have any problems, no deficits, no lack. It's not like that. And there's a need for us to start like a children's church, a children's program. You see what I'm saying? Because you know we have children. You hear what I'm saying? Y'all didn't hear what I'm saying. I said we have children. And our children need to be fed the way that they will understand. And so I'm going to hold some of you to this, that we need, say, two. If we start with two willing volunteers, you can think about it and let me know. Two willing volunteers between now and next Youth Day. Our youth will lead out in service, and then we will be able to provide for them what they need to continue to grow. What I love about Brother Damari's son, this is the minister of music's son. Give him a round of applause. This is his first time visiting here. Brother Damari's son. Listen, all he's doing right now is his Jericho walk and his praise dance around the church. That's why when y'all got up and tried to get him, I did like this. I said, don't even mess with my Jericho walker and my praise dancer. You know, Sister Pat, I've been waiting for you. They told me that Sister Pat is the church praise dancer. Now, you know, he's giving you a little run for your money right now, Sister Pat. He is showing you up. He is showing you up. Listen, God is good. We're going to give the children their space. We're going to give the children what they need to grow and to mature in the ways of the Lord. You hear what I'm saying? So all we're going to need is just two. It's just going to be two volunteers. And so by next youth day, our young people are going to lead out in church. And then we're going to have a whole youth program for them, because it's not only what they deserve, but it's our responsibility. Amen. Come on now. Come on. That was good, in Jesus' name.
Good afternoon. The Design Youth will now receive your gifts from the tithes and offerings. He will come from the back to the front. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Generous Father, thank you that all things were created through you and for you. You are before all things, and in you all things exist. The Bible says that we should bring our tithes and offerings into your storehouse, and that you will respond by opening the windows of heaven and sending down blessing upon blessing. Accept the gifts we place before you now. May the peace of God reign in our lives, the love of God surround us, the Spirit of God empower us, and the joy of God uphold us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Hello, church. Please stand for the benediction, please. Now, my friends, I want to say this to you. Fill your minds with the thoughts about good things. Think about the things that are true, clean, right, and lovely. Always think about the things which people know are very good. Remember what I have taught you. Remember the message that you heard from me. Remember what you saw when I live among you. You also must do those same things. God is the one who gives us peace in our minds. He will always be with you. Philippians 4:8-9. Amen.
Thank you. Let the church say amen, and you are dismissed. Praise God.